I am on fire today, and I hope you are too. This is 2:13. This is our time. This is our opportunity. Carpe diem. Seize the day. Seize the moment. Seize the opportunity. Push the obstructions out of the road. There are roadblocks that are blocking our way, and they imagine that these roadblocks insist they have the authority to block our way. And what we say is, you have the right to imagine you have the authority, but we have the right to recognize that authority, that imagination has no real authority. Okay, so that's how we're able to push these roadblocks out of the way, these icons, these roadblocks that are telling us that we're supposed to worship flesh-based identity, egoic identity, instead of accepting spiritual identity, which is what God created. God created spiritual identity, that is spirit. God did not create egoic identity, which is flesh. Did not, and energy and all this, the subtle interplay of energy that we call flesh. God did not create that. Or that hypothetical scenario we are imagining, and so it's an imaginary authority. So of course there are those who block the road and tell us, you cannot pass. You cannot pass to spiritual identity, and they say that they have the authority to tell you, you cannot pass. And we say, well, that's thank you, but we don't recognize the authority of imagination. It's not necessary, and therefore we're able to pass through. We're able to push these icons, these roadblocks out of the way, who are telling us that the road to happiness is through worshiping egoic fake identity, which has no foundation in reality, no foundation in anything, has no foundation at all. It's just imagination. It's a hypothetical what if scenario, which is all that existence is what if reality were vulnerable to being annihilated. What will we do then? Well, we'd need to find some other identity, need to find some other reality. We need to survive the annihilation and all of that. And so we're working on that. We don't need to work on it. We don't need to work on it. So many, many, many topics that we can get to. We are, as we wait for to showcase spiritual identity. What was Ramana Maharshi? He was spiritual identity showcasing. Spiritual identity showcasing itself here in this world. What was Jesus Christ? Spiritual identity showcasing itself in this world. What was Buddha? What was Ananda Maima? What were these great? They were showcasing spiritual identity. It was spiritual identity showcasing itself here. It wasn't ego showcasing spiritual identity. It was spiritual identity showcasing itself here, so we would know this is what we truly are, and this is what we need to accept, and we need to tell everything that's saying we everything that's blocking the road, saying sorry, but I have to move you out of the way so I can get through. Gently, kindly, but say, you know, I'm not accepting your roadblock. Very, very important right now, because the massive marketing and campaign and push in this world is to find a better form of egoic identity to worship. You see, what we have been wasting time in is seeking for a better form of egoic identity to worship. That's not the way. The way is to say egoic identity is no identity at all. It's imaginary identity. It's not God-created identity. It will never make us happy. What we're doing in the world is trying to find a way to be happier with egoic identity. And so the world is caught up in this transition, this hope and change, where we're changing to worshiping a different type of egoic identity, which I call is the Dracos, which is extraterrestrial entities that dwell on other planets in this universe, this galaxy. They have a wide confederacy, and they're like colonialists. They're imperialists coming in to this planet and taking it over, like the colonialists and the settlers in America came over to America and displaced and took over the land from the Indians and instituted their culture. What the election in 2012 was about cultural identity. And one side won and one side lost. The Draco side, about homogenizing the world, submerging all cultural identity into sort of one lowest common denominator, which is easily controlled from a top-down, centralized, draconian bureaucracy and governmental structure, which is what they want. That's what won the election. And those who at least were holding on, clinging to the hope they could realize spiritual identity, they lost the election, which is what was foreseeable. So when you put your faith in man-made identity, man-made culture, man-made religion, all that stuff, you're going to eventually lose out. It's not stable. It's not resting on any foundation at all. So you need to put your acceptance into spiritual identity, which is why you need to find spiritual identity showcasing itself. Very important. So you see that it's there. Yes, it is true. It is there. It is what I really want, and I can accept that. Very, very important in this world. And so the effort to worship the ego, egoic identity, has tried to distract us away from spiritual identity showcasing itself in this world. What we're doing here is we're connecting with that all-important principle of spiritual identity showcasing itself here in this world, so that we can get past the roadblocks to spiritual identity, to push the Dracos and all their sycophants aside and say, no, you don't have any, you have imaginary authority, but I'm giving up imagination and recognizing it has no real authority. So that's the right way to do it. And so that is what we're about. And basically we are pointing out that, hey, this roadblock is here, but we need to, you know, push it to the side. It's a movable obstruction, as it were. And we need to do it. And we need to connect with spiritual identity as it showcases itself here. That is the right approach. Religion is not spiritual identity. Okay, it's not. It's man-made. It's human-made. It's egoic-made. Religion is egoic made. Culture is egoic made. Civilization is egoic. All of that is egoic. It is all the belief that our safety lies in establishing a new kingdom within a gap between truth and hypothetical. Okay, hypothetically, the hypothetical is that reality could be annihilated. The truth is that the reality cannot be annihilated. Then the ego says, we call it the ego, is there's a gap between those two. And within this gap, we can establish a new kingdom based on what? Neither truth nor hypothetical. So what is that kingdom based on? It's called nothing. Nothing. It's based on nothing. And the power of nothing is really what the ego's mantra is, the power of nothing. There is no gap. There is no gap between truth and hypothetical. It's either one or the other. We're either entertaining truth or we're entertaining a hypothetical. There is no other option. No other option whatsoever. Now, we can entertain a happy hypothetical. Yes, we can. And that is the remedy that God has provided for us through the Holy Spirit. We can entertain a happy hypothetical, which is the hypothetical of, say, what if reality could not be annihilated? That's called a happy hypothetical. And then that's easily translated back into accepting, oh, reality cannot be annihilated. I know that. I don't even need to think about it. It doesn't need to be a consideration anymore at all. That's how it works. That's how salvation works. Jesus says, nobody comes to the Father except through me, meaning except through accepting spiritual identity. Jesus was showcasing spiritual identity and saying, nobody comes to the Father except through spiritual identity, through accepting it. Doesn't come to the Father through religion. Comes through accepting spiritual identity. Religion can help us move in that direction, but it in itself is not it, and it can become very stale. The path needs to be fresh and vital and have juice, vigor, and it needs to feel vibrant. There needs to be some vibrancy to it. It means urgency, vibrancy, hope, expectation. Not emotionalism. No. But reasoned expectations that, yes, we can. Yes, we will. Yes, we are doing it. And we're getting there. We're getting there, and we're getting close, and we're going to accept. So what happens is all the man-made stuff gets very stale and out, and we then become vulnerable to searching for a better form of egoic fake identity to worship, instead of continuing the urgency of accepting spiritual identity. The spiritual path, it has to be, you have to run. You can't walk, you have to run. And I attend church services because I want to see. I want to evaluate. I want to say, what's going on here? And it's either one thing or the other. It's either trying to fake boosterism, which is all emotionalism, or you just try to boost yourself up in a fake way, like, yeah, we're almost there. And you get all emotional. You think, I'm almost there because I feel so emotional. And then, poof, you haven't really made any progress. As opposed to the real stale stuff that's just, everybody's just sluggish. It needs something that is not either one of those. Something that's clear and vibrant and moving fast and adamant and that sort of thing. And then saying, hey, let's have spiritual identity showcased itself right now. We don't need to merely say, well, we'll settle for something 3,000 years ago or 2,000 years ago or whatever. You know, spiritual identity is always now. It's always present. It's always now. There is no gap where time enters in between hypothetical and reality. No gap at all. So there's no time. No such thing as time. Reality is real right now. Spiritual identity is real right now. Always. So of course it can present itself right now. Absolutely can. When we say, no, the only presentation of spiritual identity has to have taken place long, long ago, or it's already taken place and it's never going to take place again, which is what the ego likes to assert. Say, no, just one showcase and then no more, that's it. Knowing that time will make it stale, knowing that it can run down through the passage of the centuries, everyone can get just like sluggish and dull, and the ego loves that. The more the merrier. Spiritual identity, showcase yourself, please, right now. Let's get a lot of examples going. Why not? And if we can get some super clear delineation, that's what we're looking for, super clear delineation. And we have to realize that the roadblocks need to be scooted off to the side so we can get through, that's all. Kindly, with love. But we cannot allow ourselves to be pinned down at this time, because the institutionalization of the Draco system here in this world is an avalanche. It's a free fall collapse, as it were, of the will of this planet to stand up to this and say, no, we don't want to waste our time worshiping a different egoic identity, a different form of egoic identity. We don't want to waste our time on that. It's a waste of time. Is we don't, the Dracos and humans, they're both egoic identity, both delusional, okay. And I'm not saying one is better than the other. Of course, we're familiar with human egoic identity, so we feel that's better, and the Dracos are familiar with their Draconian identity, and they think that's better. But really, there's nothing to choose. But you choose between one form of nothing and another form of nothing. But it's a waste of time to go through a transition where you are choosing one. Say, well, let's choose this other one. It's a waste of time. It's better to stick with what you got and to apply your efforts in the right direction. That's a lot better. So all this whole thing, my position on it is a vast waste of time, and that is not good at all, because it's delay, and it delays you from accepting your spiritual identity, which delays you from true happiness. Now, during the changeover, of course, they promise us that we're going to have true happiness. Now, the Adam and Eve parable was warning us here about how the Dracos take over worlds, because they've taken over many worlds. That's what they do. Expand. They're imperialists. They are galactic imperialists. And they come in and they crush cultural identity in a world and homogenize it, much like the imperialists did on this planet, about subjugating third world native peoples all over the planet and homogenizing them into this modern materialistic paradigm. And so the Dracos, they do that. And of course, when they come in, they promise greater happiness for everybody. And the Adam and Eve story is the story of how they do that. Now, when we talk about accepting spiritual identity, it's very important that spiritual identity has nothing to do with being with male or female, or a combination or a dyad or anything like that whatsoever. It has nothing to do with that. God did not create flesh, bodies, energy, all this stuff did not have anything to do with that. That is all the play of our own imagination. We wanted to become prime creator. We had to try to find, we had to entertain this hypothetically. And so this hypothetical entertainment of this idea is in our imagination, and we have come up with all this stuff. Male, female, bodies, planets, all this kind of stuff. We came up with it. At least our perception of all of this is based on our own imagination. But God did not create flesh at all. That is totally delusional to say that. God created spirit, spiritual identity, essence, idea. So we have this male-female thing in this play of hypothetical, and we're trying to figure this out. There's no need to figure it out, but we do need to be wise about it, because as we identify with a male or a female, we have the problems that go along with that, and they're slightly different problems. We have some practical problems we need to be very careful with. Now, the female, identifying with a female, brings up a set of problems, and the number one, several major problems that you have to be very alert about and guard against, which is what religions try to teach us. Say, hey, there's some real problems you need to be alert for. Say, I'm not down on religion. They have its place, but it's not the end. It's not the end. It's a means, and it needs to be vibrant, and it needs to be fast, and it needs to be effective. So the identifying with a female flesh form brings out the issue of flattery. Females are very vulnerable to worshiping the source of flattery. Okay, and what does how are they flattered? By telling them that they are super capable, in fact, all capable of bringing happiness to men. So females are told, yes, you have the capability to bring supreme happiness to men, and you're the source of happiness. And there's an extreme vulnerability to worship the source of this flattery. And of course, the Dracos know that very, very well, and they're able to use this flattery. And what they tell the females is, hey, the problem here is that men don't appreciate that you can bring them supreme happiness. They're not appreciative of it. They don't have the gratitude for it. And women go, yeah, that's true. If they just were more grateful, I'm sure they would understand that I can bring them supreme happiness. In other words, egoic identity being the source of happiness, where it's absolutely not. And females are also vulnerable to the flattery of saying, look, we can keep you beautiful. Vanity. Saying you can be so beautiful that the men will just fall down and worship you and say, oh, you are the source of all my happiness. And so that is the extreme vulnerability women have. Dracos absolutely exploit that and have exploited it here in this world. That's the Adam and Eve thing. The snake, Dracos, go to the female Eve and say, hey, if you eat of this fruit, you know, you're going to make your man really, really happy. And she says, oh, yeah, great. I'll do that because I want my man to be happy. Not realizing that happiness only comes through accepting spiritual identity. That's the only way. Doesn't come from flesh at all. Can never come from flesh. Now, men, they're a little more simple, basic, as far as they have one big, big vulnerability, but it's a monster. And that is they're vulnerable to women. To believing that women can bring them happiness. That is their big vulnerability. And women are very smart, females very smart, and they play this dynamic very, very adroitly. And what they don't say that what they say is to the man is, look, we can bring you supreme happiness, but you have to be worthy of this. They don't say, men, go work for us. What we really want is for you to give us all these comforts, because that seems too materialistic. And they say, oh, that's not a good way to sell it. So they say, men, we can bring you supreme happiness, but you have to be worthy for it. They don't say, do something for me. They say, prove to me you're worthy of it, because I don't want to bestow my bliss upon you unless you're worthy of it. And the men say, okay, where's the challenge? I say, but I see, here's a challenge. See, what women really want is they want luxury and comforts and status and all these beautiful homes and palaces and servants and all this stuff. But they don't want to tell the men, and they want men to be their slaves to bring them this stuff, but they don't want to say it that way. So they say, I can bestow ultimate bliss upon you, and I will, but you have to be worthy of it. So how are you going to prove that to me? And then and they kind of like, gee, I don't really know how you can prove that. And then they kind of say, well, you know, look at that house over there. I wonder if you could build a house like that. Or look at this, you know, look at this wonderful situation. Or look at these beautiful dresses these other ladies are wearing. I wonder if you could get that for me. That would be a big challenge. Or there's this person over there I don't like. Maybe you can get rid of them. Or there's this country I really want to add this to my kingdom. And that would be a nice challenge. What do you think? And the man said, yeah. I want some bliss. So whatever challenge, whatever is going to show that I'm worthy, I'm going to do it. Then the man sets about 100% trying to accomplish this, which is, of course, exactly what the female really wants for herself to get. So there's this very exploitive dynamic taking place here between male and females. And men are just stupid. They keep falling for it. They have extreme vulnerability to women being manipulated by women. And women have an extreme vulnerability to being manipulated by subtle flattery and the arts of vanity, of being beautiful and attractive and all that stuff. Because that, of course, that enables women to get what they want, which is all the material luxuries and comforts and power and everything through manipulating men. So there is this extremely bad system, and it's not just a system, it's just vulnerability of the ego. This whole dynamic is just rotten to the core. Men have to realize that women have no capacity to give men happiness whatsoever, no capacity to give bliss whatsoever. The only capacity is just cheap thrills. There's no bliss there whatsoever. Flesh has no capacity to give us what we really want. None. Zero. And men have to realize that, have to begin realizing that. And when men begin realizing that, women will say, well, wait a minute, I can't really manipulate men anymore. And then they'll turn on the Dracos, the flatterers, and say, hey, you're selling me a load of bull here. I don't have any capacity to get what I really want through men. And what I really want is spiritual identity. And then they will drop this whole masquerade and become very pious, very righteous, very modest, and stop this manipulation game. They won't be so vulnerable to flattery and vanity and all this stuff, which is what religions teach. Very important to for both men and women to recognize their weaknesses. Super important. And to live a lifestyle that takes their weaknesses into account instead of celebrating their weaknesses. But what the Dracos want us is to celebrate our weaknesses. They say, men, celebrate the fact that you're vulnerable to women and you believe that women can bring you bliss. Worship women. That the Dracos tell men they're supposed to worship women. Okay? That's what the Dracos, the deceivers, that actually want us to worship them, you see. But that's how that they get the intermediate step to us actually then transferring worship onto them. They say, men, that the women are your source of bliss. They're the source of ultimate happiness. And you must worship them as the goddess, and you will be blissful from that. And they tell the women, you need to make sure that the men do worship you. So you need to work really hard on your body image, on your beauty, on your sexiness, on your attractiveness, on your clever sleaziness, as it were, to keep the men attached to this false ideal of getting bliss from the flesh. You need to work on that. So you need to work on your beauty, augment your features, present yourself as this very svelte, super sexy in shape, accomplished, beautiful courtesan type of the image. And that whole culture in this world is going in that direction. It's faster than we can even imagine. So, you know, telling women, oh, you women need to be goddesses. Why? To get the men, keep the men stupid. So, because men have a tendency to wise up, you see. They have a tendency to wise up because they're low person. They're low on the totem pole, actually. This whole nonsense about how men are ruling the roost is just absolute nonsense. Men are the lowest step on the totem pole in existence, which is why they tend to trend more towards freedom, because after a while they say, hey, this isn't working. I work myself to death to give women this all their finery and beauty and luxury and comforts, everything that make them beautiful, but I'm not really getting any true happiness back in return for that. And then I get criticized for not working hard enough and saying it's all my fault because I'm not making them beautiful enough. If I just made them more beautiful and worship women, then I would be happy. And I've tried as best I can. It doesn't work. And I'm exhausted. I feel like I'm dying. I've spent my whole life slaving away and I've gotten nothing out of it. And so there's a tendency for men to say, hey, wait a minute. You know, this is terrible. This is really terrible. And then they start saying, turning towards, you know, is there anything better? Is there anything at all better? And then they find out. So it often goes that way. So the Dracos know that, and they're desperate. They're here to break the spiritual will of men on this planet. Because men would say, no, Dracos, we don't want this whole goddess culture coming back, because we've been there and done that, and it was horrible. It really was. In ancient times, the whole goddess thing was absolutely horrible for men. You'd have men slaving their whole lives, building these stupid monuments and pyramids and big idols to the ego, as the queen and the ladies-in-waiting manipulated the priestly class, and the whole thing was awful. The goddess of, you know, ancient worship was worship of the goddess, which is worship of the ego, egoic identity. And we're going back to that. The Dracos have brought that back to this planet. And of course the men are saying, we don't want that. And a lot of women are saying, we don't want that too, because they know very well the wasted time that they've been through. They don't want to go through another cycle. Are you kidding? They don't really want to play the goddess role anymore. Been there and done that. And so they want to remain modest, chaste, modest, humble, and stay on track and not dispense with vanity, all the fancy clothes and makeup and hairstyles and all this whole frilly, frothy thing. Keep it plain, keep it simple, stay on track to spiritual identity. A lot of women in the world want that, but their voice is being submerged severely. And of course, when their voice is submerged, men are submerged too, because men are super vulnerable to the way that women are. If women set the social standard, and then men follow along with that. Very rarely do you get any men that can just buck the current entirely. Very rarely. So So the Dracos know that if they seduce the women of the world through flattery, and the women are worshiping the source of this flattery, and they say, "We'll do anything you want. Just keep telling us what we want to hear," which is that men are so unappreciative. They're just sexist pigs. They don't understand your true worth, your true value. They should be absolutely blissful and worshiping at your feet for how wonderful you are, the source of all flesh and all. And men are supposed to be that way. Men are terrible. And the women say, "Yeah. Keep flattering us. Yeah, we want to hear. You know, where? How can we get identity?" And then Draco said, "Well, through men worshiping you. That's how you get identity." And they say, okay, we just want to get that identity. So the Dracos know that if they get the women to go along with this, then the men are going to capitulate, which is what has happened. Very few men can withstand that, and those that do got help. A man standing on by himself is not going to be able to withstand the barrage that is about this planet, which is why most men have just basically thrown in the towel. And then when women see men throwing in the towel, they say, "Oh, what the heck? You know, men are just going to keep being stupid. So, what can we do? We might as well exploit them. Keep exploiting them. Go dig. You know, go down in the mines. Dig more coal. Dig more precious minerals. Go get that stuff so I can wear more jewelry. So I can wear more beautiful clothes. So I can showcase myself as the source of happiness and bliss, as opposed to spiritual identity." But nobody really wants this. Nobody really wants it. They just don't see an alternative is the problem here. There are a lot of quote-unquote young souls or very naive aspects of spirit in this world now who think they want it. But those of us who have been around the block, we don't want it at all. And there's a lot of those on this planet. We don't want it. But we need to see an alternative. Now, I saw an alternative, which is why I'm able to speak up now. I saw an alternative. I saw the showcasing during our age. It's so important that this Draco take over this planet, that we have examples of spiritual identity here and now, so that we can differentiate here and now. We can do it conceptually, it's possible, but it's better to have an actual examples among us. That's better. And in the 20th century, we had some very profound spiritual spiritual identity examples among us. Very, very profound. And I'm looking for, in the 21st century, I'm looking for those very clear-cut delineations. Very, very clear-cut. And praying and hoping, I've been praying and hoping for a long time, actually. And as of yet, I have not come across the very clear-cut delineations. So we're able to say, this is spiritual identity. And therefore, knowing what it is, we know what it isn't, what isn't spiritual identity, and we're able to easily see it. That's why I was able to work through all this stuff, because I had some true examples of true spiritual identity. You can say Ramana Maharshi, and you can say Ananda Maima. Recently, those were the ones. There's a two, and some other people will also mention some others that they, for them, they felt that that was true spiritual identity. And by knowing what true spiritual identity is really like, what's really about, you then can say to other stuff that say that's not it. That's egoic identity, grandiose, glorified egoic identity, but it's not spiritual identity. So we're in this time now where we need to differentiate and need to choose one or the other. Very, very important time. We need to recognize our weaknesses. We need to realize that the world is mostly capitulated. And it's not like you're going, it's not an easy thing, because they just, the spiritual will has collapsed on this planet. I've lived through the collapse. It's horrible. It's the worst tragedy imaginable to live through, is the spiritual collapse. The will, spiritual will, the will to accept spiritual identity. The will to do that, the will to exchange hypotheticals, the will to do that has like collapsed on this planet to an extraordinary degree. The older people still have some sense, but it's just habit. That's the problem. I go to like Catholic Church. Again, I'm not a baptized Catholic, but I go to the Catholic Church, and I observe everything with love and kindness and appreciation for the work that the Catholic Church has done throughout 2,000 years of at least trying to guide humanity towards spiritual identity. But it's become stale. It's very stale. It's very habitual. It's very going through the motions. And the older people there, they're modest. Very, very good as far as the women are very modest, the men are very humble, and there's a sense of maintaining that. It's important, but it's more a habit. They don't quite understand the urgency, the necessity for all-out effort. It's more just going and saying, well, when we die, then we'll be happy. Okay, it's not true. When you die, you don't reach spiritual identity at all. You're still in the hypothetical. God didn't create death. So when you die, how can you be in reality? There's no such thing as cycles of birth and death in reality. There's no such thing as an afterlife in reality. There's only life. There's no afterlife in reality. So you don't reach spiritual identity after you die. It's not true. You can only reach it now, always right now. And But the younger generations in the Catholic Church is, whew, my gosh, you know, hey, it's a different story. And the immodesty of the females is just shocking. It really is shocking. They feel like they can come to church and dress up like hookers, you know? It's just like, and their attitudes are not modest at all. Very brazen type of aggressive, sexually aggressive attitudes. You can feel it. There's not that true inner understanding of the vulnerabilities and weaknesses to flattery and to vanity, and the necessity to at all times guard against trying to manipulate men in that way, and trying to lead men on to thinking that men's happiness comes through women. And then the men will be also chaste and modest, and will insist on spiritual focus in the family, and that will benefit the children greatly. You see, the women are concerned about the children, of course. And they know, and the way the children are benefited is having a very modest household where the man is able to adamantly and focus and insist on spiritual values, on spending your life all out on accepting spiritual identity. That's the importance. And the man can do that, can be very adamant and very helpful. So a wise woman who wants her children to accept spiritual identity will make sure that her man is focused on that and not on the woman, you see? Focused on the truth, not on trying to get happiness through the woman. Saying, no. Focus on the truth. And then the man will do that. He can exercise that function very, very well. Can be very adamant about it. Very dynamic and adamant. That men have that capacity very strongly. So that is the proper family structure. Proper family structure. And you see the younger generations, they're caught up in the draconian thing of worshiping a different form of egoic identity. And they're following this goddess thing. They're following the goddess. I can feel the goddess dynamic entering into the church through all sorts of different ways to the younger generations. And it shouldn't be there at all. Absolutely should not be there at all. It's someplace, it's the abomination of desolation. It's the place where it shouldn't be. It's that goddess worshiping of the Dracos coming into this world to subvert the world, subvert the spiritual will of the world by causing men to drop their adamant advocacy of pursuing spiritual identity and saying to their children, hey, you know, the men need to be the authoritative to the children. Hey, look, this is the law. We're backing up the mother. The mother, of course, directs the children's growth. But when the children start acting out against that, let's say the mother says, you need to pursue spiritual identity. That's the only reason you're here. And you need to be modest and chaste. And you need to be dedicated. And you need to be humble. And you need to understand your weaknesses. And don't be all egotistical, etc. And then they start rebelling or something, are saying, you start growing up in teenage years. You need the man in the house to say, to back the mother up in this way, to back her up and say, no, this is how it is, and to set a strong, powerful example of adamancy. Very important. Having the man and the woman in the house is super important. So the Dracos have tried to bust the family unit up and get everybody, have a babysitter, have the television as a babysitter. The television is basically just the mouthpiece for the Draco takeover of this planet. Hollywood, television, entertainment industry, media, all that is simply the mouthpieces, the horns, as it were, for the Draco takeover of this planet. And so you get the mother not home, you see, and the children just being babysit by a television. It's a disaster. That's why younger generations have gotten so misguided. They're so misguided, so misled. And right now, they spend all their time. I see the kids in church are just staring at the little smartphones. They all have smartphones, playing the games in church. And when they go out of church, they're constantly like this. And what I find is the younger generation cannot relate in a spiritual, loving way to others. When I'm like go to a store and I'm waited on by young people, they have this very sullen, very detached, very robotic kind of way of interacting. It's like bizarre. I'm saying, well, what the hell's going on here? Is something wrong with me? And then I talk to other people. They say, oh no, I have the same experience. I say, oh, it's not me. It's why? Because they're used to relating to this little, you know, games on a screen. They're going around like this. They're not relating to people. Relating to people is nuanced, and it has to be intuitive, and it has to come from love. And like when I'm driving, I have to keep love in my heart at all times and for everybody. It's absolutely essential, because if you don't have that, you're going to get in trouble on the road. If you're on the road as much as I am, the reason why I'm able to stay safe on the road is because of that love for everybody, meaning I respect everyone equally. Everyone has a car. You gotta respect it, right? You can't say, well, I don't care about that one there, because they can hit you just as much as any other car, any other vehicle. So you have to have this feeling like I'm gonna look out for everybody on the road, myself and everybody else equally. And therefore that helps you, and pedestrians and everything else. And that helps you avoid tragedies. And there have been many near tragedies I've had on the road, but I know that it's the willingness to love others that has kept me safe in that way. Now, you can only rely on the vitality of youth so long in this world. And if that's all you're relying upon, you're in big, big trouble. And to have people spend their whole formative years just engrossed in this little screen in front of their eyes, this smartphone, is hideous. It's 100% Draco. It's dehumanizing the planet. It's roboticizing the planet. It's turning the planet into something that's easily controlled by their bureaucracy, which is what they want. They want the planet to be easily controllable through the bureaucracy. They don't want problems. The Dracos don't want problems. Just like human governments don't want problems. Although, when humans are in control, they allow a certain amount of disagreement and protest and divergent opinions. It's not all smooth. The Dracos appeal to those who want efficiency and control and smooth, neat, clean, everything. Like Singapore, you know, like that kind of thing. Everything's like, what is this, a hospital or something? Or you look at Singapore, and it's like, wow, does anybody live here? Yeah, that's the question. Anybody really live here? I mean, it's just like an obsession with efficiency and cleanliness and all the spotlessly, everything's this way. But the Dracos are even more, they want efficiency, they want control, they want everything. They say that happiness comes through control. Okay, that's their thing. And humans are different. We say, you know, happiness comes through expressing ourselves or something like that. So it's very, very different. And the Dracos have now pushed this control system on the planet through their technology that they have seeded here in this planet by sending those who are used to living in Draco worlds, having them incarnate here and develop all these gadgets and market all these gadgets like a Steve Jobs or something like that. Very draconian, very dictatorial. You see, very control freak. Draconians are control freaks, absolute control freaks, on a global scale. They're very used to controlling entire planets, not just some little fiefdom. Entire planets and sectors of space. They're control freaks, and that's what they're doing here. They want to institute absolute control, and they hate the American Constitution, because that's the body of entitlement, that the number one body of entitlement on the entire planet is the American Constitution, and they hate it. They want to destroy it. They want to get rid of it, and they're doing a good job of doing that right now. And because it says, hey, we have a right to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, or right to freedom of religion, freedom of speech, freedom of expression, without the government interfering that in whatever way. And we have the right to demand that the government protect us from being harmed when we are expressing our opinions. We have the right to that. And we have right not to be branded as a hate group just because some other group doesn't like what we have to say. See, all that stuff is under total attack right now. And they're demolishing the freedoms that Americans have, absolutely demolishing them. And once they get Americans to go along with their plan, the planet is completely, that's it, it's over. And that's actually already happened, the election in 2012, it's over. It's happened. And they got their man that in the White House, they got what they want, and it's finished. America's finished. Constitution's finished, all of that, because the whole structure of bringing it down is already in place. It's just there has to be someone in the White House who's going to look the other way, who's going to say, well, yeah, it's, hey, no problem, go ahead. Then it will take place. Whereas if you had someone in the White House who vigorously opposed it and would fight it tooth and nail, then America would have had a fighting chance. But as of now, no, because at the top, if the executive branch says, hey, whatever the Dracos want to do is cool with me, as long as I'm seen as a Superman, it's all okay. Then of course it's going to happen, because the ways to detonate the Constitution are already in place. Actually, all the various executive orders that can click into place to very easily click into place are already there. It's already there. It just has to be someone at the helm. It's like the ship, like the captain just has to be away from the bridge in order to crash the ship. That's all it takes. It's all the reefs are there, the shoals are there to wreck the ship. And all it has to be is a captain who doesn't care if the ship is wrecked, because too wrapped up in their own ego, and then the ship is wrecked. And once that ship of state of America is wrecked, the whole planet will succumb to the Dracos. And that is going to happen. That election sealed the deal. sealed the deal, which is why 213 is so important, because it's going to happen. And we need to know what our options are, and our options are to accept spiritual identity. Because spiritual identity, you know that imagination has no authority, no real authority. It only has imaginary authority, okay? The Dracos only have imaginary authority, and their proxies here that I spoke about in the previous video, they have many proxies here that have been helping the world get ready for them and get used to accepting them. They only have imaginary authority. All authority in existence is only imaginary authority. Other than the Holy Spirit is that which speaks for reality, so that's true authority, but it only offers us the happy hypothetical. That's all that it does. It says, hey, accept this happy hypothetical, the hypothetical that reality cannot be annihilated. And then that can be easily set down for reality. So the authority of reality is basically to say, accept reality as it is, just reminding us. It's just a reminder. It's just a reminder. Very strong reminder. And the Holy Spirit has this reminder for waiting for us to accept it. Healed perception, vision of Christ, the overlay, the real world, the happy hypothetical, those are all terms for the same thing. The blessed version of existence, all of that. That is what we can do. And by seeing spiritual identity showcasing itself here on the planet, we say, that's what we really want. How do we get it? Okay, we exchange this very unhappy nightmare for a happy dream. A nightmare for a happy dream. It's still a dream, yeah. Holy Spirit knows that. It's not deluded. Holy Spirit is not saying there's some gap to establish a kingdom there. Holy Spirit is saying there's no gap, but we won't. You can still utilize the imagination that there's a kingdom there, but just seeing that it's not in any gap. It's a hypothetical. What if there were no gap? As long as we're saying there's a gap, we need to exchange it for, well, what if there were no gap? You see that? That is how we do it. What if a reality could be annihilated? We exchange that for what if it couldn't be annihilated? Still hypothetical. So we remain within the hypothetical, but exchange hypotheticals. That is the way that Jesus pointed out in A Course in Miracles. He said that is the way salvation in it. That totally resonates with me. Totally resonates, because it deals with the problem of continuity, which is all important. Familiarity, continuity. We've worked so hard on building up this kingdom in this imaginary gap on a foundation of nothing. We don't want to just throw the whole kingdom away because it's unreal. We want to say, we're used to it. So Holy Spirit says, no problem. We'll just give a blessed version of this kingdom that you'll see. That it's already blessed right now, all of it. It's already done. It was done instantly. The Holy Spirit holds this out to us every moment. So there, we don't need any Dracos to build up this kingdom. It's already completely blessed by the Holy Spirit. You see, that is where our salvation lies. That is where we find it. So we are now, we need to be on fire. We need to have the vibrancy. We need to have the urgency. We need to get rid of that sluggishness, with all respect to all the religions and helpers in the world. The vibrancy has to be there. And the modesty has to be there. And the humility has to be there. And the purpose has to be there. The urgency, the vibrancy. We got to say, we're going to get it this year. We're going to get it now. We're going to get it now. No afterlife. Because if we don't get it now, we are going to end up worshiping the Dracos. Or being martyred, basically. One of the two. And again, being martyred doesn't bring you into the kingdom. It does not. You have to accept the happy hypothetical first, and then that gets easily translated into the kingdom, or into reality. And there's no death in the happy hypothetical whatsoever. There's no death. No death. None. No annihilation. None. And you can only do that now, always now. Even if when you pass away, you still have to do it now in the afterlife. You'll still have to do it now. And if you don't do it now, you'll find yourself reincarnating. But for most of us, if we don't accept spiritual identity, if we don't make the exchange of hypotheticals, we'll end up being kowtowing to the Dracos and their bureaucracy and governance and social system, everything they set up, the laws, etc. And we'll be put in a gulag. I've already been in a gulag for quite some time, actually, because I was not willing to go along with them, and they put a lot of pressure on me because I could have helped them a lot, and I said I refused to help them, and they got really, really mad at me, to say the least. So I've basically been given the dregs of on this planet, sudra, an untouchable type of situation, which, you know, slave class, because they see us, well, you're not willing to do anything, so we got to find something for you to do, so you pick up the corpses, so to speak. Of course, I don't want to be doing that. I shouldn't be doing that. But I have to get free of that. That's not right use of my time. My right use of my time is showcasing spiritual identity on this planet. That's right use of my time. Because that helps. That truly helps. It truly helps. That's what has helped me get to this point of being able to speak out about this in an adamant way, which is what men are supposed to be doing. And women are supposed to be raising children with the right orientation. That's what women are valuable. The most super valuable thing is a woman raising the children to have right orientation so they can not waste their lives. Because coming to this world, it's so easy to waste your life. It is so easy to waste your life here. Almost everybody that comes here just wastes their time. And so the woman raising the children, setting in letting the children know this is right use of time here. And then the male being very adamant and very dynamic and very forceful and very clear to present the way to use your time here and this spiritual identity and showcasing and doing that. The two together, doing that is super helpful. And it's what is necessary. You get women pursuing the positions of men on this planet, helter skelter, the roles of adamancy that males are so good at, and leaving their children with their nannies, and their television and daycare and all this stuff is just and basically with their smartphones and their video games, and that is just extremely unwise and just paves the way for the Draco takeover entirely, absolutely entirely. Now, a lot of people are doing homeschooling, realizing this. They say, hey, we really need to not let our children grow up this way. We need to give them a very clear role models of what right use of time is all about on this planet. When you're identifying with the flesh, right use of time is all important. And young people need role models. They need patterns, they need models, they need to see, this is what is possible, this is what I can do. Because it's tough to grow up. It's really very, very difficult to go through the stages of growing up and then fitting into society is super difficult. And without good role models, it makes it just devastatingly difficult. And what happens is, it gets so difficult, people then just start longing for some other form of the ego to worship, and they're so easily manipulated by celebrities. So easily manipulated by celebrities, celebrity culture. I was fortunate in my life to have a situation where the spiritual was emphasized, spiritual identity was emphasized. And of course, I myself was part of emphasizing it. And in fact, I emphasized it so much, I drove my family crazy. They didn't want that much emphasis. They said, well, a little bit, but you're too much emphasis. Gotta leave us alone. So I did, I left them alone basically, because I cannot stop it. It's all important. Because I knew this takeover was coming, the Draco takeover was coming, I knew it. Coming into this world, of course. In the subtle realms, afterlife realms, you are aware, more aware of what's going on in the cosmos, and you're able to see subtly what's taking place, the level of intentions. So it's easy to see what's going to happen on this planet in the afterlife, and you can bring that into incarnation and have awareness of what's going to happen in the future here, which is what I did. So I knew all this would take place. That's why I've worked my entire life as fast as possible to be available at this point in time. do as much as I possibly can, but my hands are tied. If there's no showcasing of spiritual identity here, or at least not really clear cut, what can I do? What can anyone do? They can only work at the conceptual, and they can work at as much as they can with whatever spiritual identity they can find, whatever the best that they can find, that's the best they can do. But it's going to get more difficult now. See, that's what I'm where I'm coming from. Yes, there are spiritual teachers who have where spiritual identity is in play. I feel it's in play to some extent. I don't get a sense that there's some, just absolutely pure, nothing but spiritual identity. I don't quite get that sense. But the thing is during 2013 now starting, is in the next 13, 14, 15, 16, next 4 years, it's curtains. It's curtains for the planet. It's curtains. That's it. We need clear-cut 100%er, or several, or many now, that showcase spiritual identity in order to offset this collapse of spiritual will on this planet and the planet turning towards worshiping egoic identity in a different format. We need that. We need 100%ers. See, I'm looking ahead. I'm looking ahead, knowing what's coming, saying this is what is needed to offset the deluge, the collapse, absolute collapse of spiritual will on this planet, the collapse. And so we really need the best that is the best possible is what we need right now. We don't need 90%ers. We need 100%ers. And so I've always worked from the standpoint of knowing what's going to come basically in the world and then knowing what the remedy has to be. And it has to be that right now. We need 100%ers here. Otherwise, we're just spitting into the ocean or trying to get the water out of the ocean with a cup or something. It's pretty futile. It's pretty futile. And so that's what I expect, because I pray for it. I ask for it. I expect it. I prepare. I'm willing. And I see it. The application, to see the relevancy of it, all that. So I'm 100% open. I'm saying, I can't say I'm 100% anything really, but I'm very willing and open to help present 100%ers. Help say, yeah, this is it, this is it, this is it, this is a 100%er. Welcome, welcome, welcome. Roll out the red carpet for the 100%ers. Roll it out. And realize, hey, help keep it on track, because of course people will, their ambivalency will cause them to get all sorts of notions about it, which does happen. It does happen, but where that happened with me, it happens with people. They start trying to turn the 100%er into a little bit fleshy type of, see, I've seen that happen to people who are very much into the image of spiritual imagery, start to manipulate that and make it turn it towards more fleshy type of situations, which is not right, not appropriate. There should be modesty and chastity at all times in the situation. Absolutely. The immodesty of this planet is absolutely insane. It's, and everyone's celebrating this as if it's some kind of liberation. It's not, it's enslavement. It's leading to draconian enslavement of the planet. Is what it's really leading to. And men hate it. They really hate it. And to tell you the truth, from the standpoint of men, I talked to many, many men, hate it. They hate immodest women. Really, well, despise that. Don't like it at all. Because they know it's exploitation. They're being exploited. They know it. They're being enslaved. They're being exploited. They don't like it at all. They don't have any genuine love or respect for that at all. Cannot. And they see a modest woman, a truly modest, humble, they say, ah, that's what we really want. That is what we really want. That's what's really helpful. That's what's good for our children. That's what's good for me, for her, for the children, for everybody, for society, for civilization. That's what's good for it. We know that, but we're too vulnerable to the unchaste women. We're too vulnerable to it. And the Dracos know that. They exploit these loopholes. They're very clever at exploiting loopholes. They've exploited all the loopholes in this planet and taking it over. It's the Eve principle. They were able to exploit Eve And because Eve thought, hey, this is going to be great for my children, my husband, my children, because we're going to be have all these material luxuries. We're going to have all these cool stuff, gadgets, and this is going to be great. I'm going to be able to attend all these wonderful parties, and I'm going to have, like, incredibly great clothes to wear. And I'm able to, if I start looking old, I'll be able to get all this cosmetic surgery, and I'm able to travel all over the place, and I'll have beautiful homes and beautiful everything and beautiful kitchens. Everything will be, you know, really great. My children will love it, and I'll be happy. My husband will be happy. My children will be happy. So they thought they were leading everyone to happiness, but they're really leading everyone into great misery, terrible misery. And of course, some recognize this. A lot of them did, but the media was able to just stifle their voices, and they're irrelevant because they're not covered. It's not covered. The coverage is all important, right? What's highlighted, what's emphasized through television, through all the popular media, now the social networks. What is covered is what happens. What is not covered essentially is hardly even happening, it seems like, at all in the world. So it's just without, don't want to get too negative about the coverage, but it is really bad. Really, really bad. I tried so many efforts to present ways to highlight what's really great in the world, what's really positive, what's really happening, but nobody's really interested because we're too interested in celebrity, or it's just we've gotten accustomed to the way the media entertainment industry works, and we become habituated to it even though we don't like it. We can't quite drag ourselves out of that rut that we're in. We really cannot. I've tried. People won't respond. They will not respond. And I know there are those viewers who have also tried, and they realize what I'm saying. People really don't respond, do they? They really don't. Only if you get 100% or here is there some response. The people can't help themselves. They have to respond in some way. They just say, wow. And they might say, oh, they're so beautiful, or they're so something relating to the flesh. But what they're really saying is, oh, I'm feeling what I really want here. And they're so used to thinking what they want is the flesh. They put it in that context. But still something is in them says, you know, I'm missing something that I really want. I'm not getting it. I don't feel this culture's going to give it to me. I feel like the boat is going to sail. I'm going to miss my opportunity. I don't want to miss my opportunity. That is what you feel with 100%, or you say, oh my gosh. And a lot of people just break into tears, really. They just break down. They just, because they say, oh my God, I'm so sad that I've been missing this. Missing this has just been horrible, just horrible. Of course, missing our spiritual identity is a nightmare. We're not without it. It's just we're dreaming, we're imagining of a hypothetical, what if we were without it, you see? This is very careful, very important. This is something I'm very, fortunately, very good at, in emphasis, because I've worked at it my whole life and been able to, at least to some extent, not fall prey to only doing what the glamorous women want me to do. Not being manipulated, controlled by the female dynamic here. I've been able to keep adamant emphasis going. But not that it hasn't been shaky at times. It has, definitely. But I've been able to, the fire is still burning here, you see. You can tell the fire is still burning, hasn't been put out. And that was not easy. That was not easy. The emphasis is, if I can get back to that. The ability to put the right emphasis, the ability to talk about these situations in such adamant ways is super important. And I'm able to bring up the happy hypothetical. I'm able to talk about the very root of the problem that we're experiencing. And just keep on keeping on. And the fact that we're so unhappy, and the fact that we have never left reality at all, and yet we are imagining, what if we were to leave? What if we were to be separated from our spiritual identity? Okay, that's what I was trying to get to. What if we were separated from our spiritual identity? What if we didn't have it anymore? But this is a hypothetical. It's a what if. It's imagination. or using the mind is imagining for us. What a scenario, imaginary. What if we didn't have our spiritual identity? What would we do? We have to find another one, right? So we're looking for an egoic identity, some other identity. But it's only imaginary. We haven't lost our identity. We haven't lost it. We haven't been separated from it. Right this instant, we have it. Every instant we have it. And we all say, yeah, but what if the next instant we didn't? That never happened. Will never happen. But we can always say, well, what if it could? And then we're lost in this dream of searching for another identity and vulnerability to constantly worshiping some other format of this fake, non-existent identity, which makes us vulnerable to delay, which is what's happening now. The Dracos are simply delay. A form of delay is all they really are. It's a form of delay. We don't need it. We don't really want it. We don't need it. And yet the world has capitulated to this, as worlds have done, because they're very clever at that, of saying, hey, here's a better form of spirit, of egoic identity, better form of egoic identity to hang your hat on, right? And people beat it up. They don't have the resistance to it. Those who have followed the restrictions of spiritual ethics, morality, and restrictions, saying you must lead a very humble, chaste life, they have resistance to it. They have resistance to it because they're not attracted to it. They say, well, we're not attracted to this. We don't want this. But that has been attacked, subverted. And the Dracos told all the women, hey, you're being suppressed. You're being held down. You're not bringing happiness to the world because the men don't appreciate you. You should get out there and do the jobs they're doing. Basically, they say you should leave your children alone so we can get to them. That is what they really were all about. That's what they were all about, is saying, women, don't pay any attention to their children anymore. Let us deal with it. Let the government deal with the education. Let the television deal with it. Let these games deal with it. Let the video games. Let all this stuff deal with the education. And you just are here to drive your husband to work himself to death so he have enough money to buy all the stuff for your children, to give them all this, you know, cool stuff and have a cool upbringing so that they're all ready to worship the Dracos, this new egoic form of fake, non-existent identity. That's what's happened across the board. And as America goes, so does the world go, because America was held up as the world ideal to freedom. And now this freedom has been subverted. Now it's being held up as a world ideal of non-freedom, really. Of how to throw away your freedom. Of how to be liberated from what? Liberated from religion? Why? We mean liberated from living a disciplined, dedicated, right, truly righteous, pious life. That's being freed from that. What is that? That's being freed to jump into the boiling oil. How's that freedom? What if you have a temptation to jump into boiling oil? And some teacher comes and tells you, hey, look, you got the severe temptation and you don't do it because you're going to suffer horribly. So here's some rules and regulations we're going to give you. And you have to follow these very dedicatedly. Religious means to be very dedicated to following the strictures that are important, helpful for you. And the teacher gives you these and you follow these rules and you don't jump into the boiling oil, because every time you're tempted, you say, well, wait a minute, I need to center, I need to be humble, I need to understand my weaknesses, I need to pray for help from the Holy Spirit, I need to all this. And you do this stuff every day, you keep understanding your vulnerability, your weakness, and keep praying for help and strength, and you don't jump into the boiling vat of oil. And then along come these Dracos saying, hey, my gosh, what's the matter with you? You're being suppressed. You're being repressed. You're being held back. You're not happy because of that. All these strictures are making you very unhappy. You need to get rid of this stuff. You need to be liberated from this stuff. You need to teach your children. This stuff is nonsense. Come on, get with the times. Be progressive. Be cool. Be hip. Be a swinger. Come on, get with it. And then after a while, what happens? People start jumping into the boiling oil. That's what's happened on this planet. That is what has happened. Because religion is not an end in itself. And the Dracos say, hey, wait, religion hasn't brought you happiness. Come on. No, it doesn't. But it prevents you from jumping into the boiling oil. Thus, it prevents delay. And it keeps you on track, gravitating towards accepting your spiritual identity as it is. It keeps you on track from exchanging hypotheticals. Keeps you on track. but it's not an end in itself, no. But the Draco said, hey, this hasn't worked. Trying to make you think it's an end in itself, it hasn't worked, and then getting you to drop it for this glamorous tinsel. Tinseltown, that's what they call it, Tinseltown. And Tinseltown has projected this image all over the world of America. Oh, it's just all the superficial materialism, all this stuff. It's not true. The roots of America are religious and pious. I mean, the Puritans, very pious people. And many, many Americans are still very pious, but it's been eroded to, for me, a drastic extent, because it's more habit now than a living vibrancy of expectation and knowing you're going to make it. It has to be this sense of knowing that you're going to make it right soon. You're going to do it. You know you're going to do it. You have to be on fire. You have to be on fire. And it has to be, it cannot be a raging flame of emotionalism. No, that's not the fire. No, it has to be a fire of bliss. You know that you're going to enter into the bliss. Instead of jumping into the boiling pot of oil, you jump into the cooling, the ever-freshness of bliss, the ever-freshness. It's this ever-fresh expectation of ever-freshness that I'm talking about. That is what we need to be on fire for, the expectation of this ever-freshness, this beautiful, crisp, clean ever-freshness is fabulous, absolutely wonderful. And that is what we will have when we exchange hypothetical scenarios. We will experience this ever-freshness. And we'll avoid jumping into the vat of boiling oil, which is what most people in this world are doing. Helter-skelter, like lemmings, they're jumping into that pot. So we need to be on fire right now, absolutely. With adamancy, not emotionalism. You see the emotionalism of some religions, that's very, very primitive. It's very primitive. I saw a clip of a journey through New Guinea, Papua New Guinea. Beautiful people, wonderful people, but they're very primitive as far. They're very easily prone to emotionalism. So you can have some very loving, smiling relationship going on with them, and then when someone says, "Oh, hey, they broke some taboo. They just broke a taboo," they go, "What?" You know, they get into this extreme emotionalism and go crazy and start. The work clubs come out, and it's like, wow. You know, just like a switch flips, and you get into that extreme. No, that's very primitive. Emotionalism is very primitive. You don't want that at all. It's very egoic. You want this fire of adamancy, of a focus. The fire of focus is what's so important. Very focused. Fire of focus. Have your fire of focus burning right now. Which is why I keep doing these videos. It's the fire of focus has to keep burning throughout each day. Every given morning, light that fire of focus. And you know that this bliss is yours when you recognize, you're willing to recognize, there is no gap. There is no place for any imaginary kingdom to be built. There is no foundation. There's either reality or a hypothetical. There's either reality or a hypothetical. There can't possibly be some option that is neither reality nor a hypothetical. It is not possible. This is what I have to emphasize. It's the fast way, the freeway, the fast way. Don't get off on these side trips. Stay with the emphasis. There is no third option between reality and a hypothetical. There is no other option. The ego insists there's another option, and you don't have to choose either between the two. You see, because we feel it's so difficult to choose between the two, the ego comes up and says, hey, you guess what? You don't have to choose between the two. There's this third option that's neither one or the other, and you can just build a kingdom there. And you say, oh, that's easy. That doesn't seem to be any trouble at all. It's total trouble. That's what keeps you bound to death and suffering and sickness and misery and unhappiness. That's what keeps you bound to it. By thinking you're taking the easy way out by this third option, which doesn't exist. So by choosing this third option, you're really just choosing the hypothetical that's already in play. That's all you're doing. But you don't realize you're doing that. That's the trick. That's the deception of the ego. You don't realize you're choosing, you're just reaffirming your loyalty to the hypothetical that you've been entertaining for so long. That's all you're doing, but you think you're doing something else. You think you're dropping it, setting it down for, not for truth, but for this third option that's neither true nor hypothetical, okay? But what the Holy Spirit, who's honest and clear, tells you is that you can set down one hypothetical for another hypothetical. Okay, that's what you can do. But this other hypothetical is not some third option which is neither truth nor hypothetical. It is still a hypothetical. The Holy Spirit's very clear about that, and I have to be very clear, emphasize this. Of course it is. But that's not what the ego's offering. The ego's offering something that's neither hypothetical nor truth. And there is no such thing. It's offering nothing to you. And then you think that you're working on this third option, that you're in this third option, and therefore you're not really in the hypothetical, nor are you in truth. Neither one. It's not true. You're still in the hypothetical. You're still in the hypothetical. But you don't realize it. You don't see it. That's the great deception, the great lie of the ego. If you just keep looking at that, keep the fire of your focus on that, you will find that the roadblocks that are blocking you from bliss and this feeling of ever freshness, total freshness at every moment, is only imaginary authority. You don't need to fight it at the level of authority. You simply deal with it at the level of hypothetical, saying, this is simply hypothetical authority. It's imaginary authority. It's not real authority at all. It's not real. Yes, it's imagined authority. And don't fight it at the level of imagination. That is the problem. That's the Barabbas problem that Jesus was trying to point out to Barabbas and the people of Judea when he was teaching back then. He was trying to point that out. He says, hey, don't oppose the Romans. You're trying to fight their authority at the level of imagination, which is their authority is only imaginary, but you're trying to oppose it also imaginary in an imaginary way. And you're going to get crushed. You're going to get martyred, which is exactly what happened. Got scattered to the winds. Jesus warned him about it. He was right. He didn't come say what they wanted was they wanted Jesus to stop the Romans and help them defeat the Romans. That's what they wanted. That's what Barabbas wanted and the revolutionaries wanted. And Jesus said, no, that's not the way. Honestly, with all love, he said, let me tell you what the way is to recognize it's only imaginary authority and you can exchange. There is no third option. You're not dwelling within some third option. You're dwelling within a hypothetical. Once you see that, then you can exchange hypotheticals. If you believe you're dwelling in some third option, which is not hypothetical nor truth, then you're not going to be willing to switch hypotheticals. You won't do it. You won't do it. You just say, why should I? I don't have any hypothetical. I've got this third option. You see what I'm saying? But if you acknowledge, say, yeah, this is all just hypothetical. There is no third option. Then the Holy Spirit says, okay, let's exchange hypotheticals. You'll say, yeah, let's do that. Let's do that. That's the way. See? All important. And so Barabbas refused. He said, no, we gotta crush the Romans. We can do it. If we just get adamant enough, we're gonna do it. No. Same thing. The idea that you can oppose the Dracos at the level of imagination is folly. It's folly. They're head crushers, you know. You don't want to do that. And which is my other channels. I mean, the other channel that I had, Clarity Ross, and this one. Always I'm stating, don't do it that way. Don't make the mistake Barabbas made in Judea, the Jews that followed the revolution against Rome. Don't do that way. Same message. I'm trying to share the message that Jesus has shared with me. And pass it on. Pass it on. Extend it. Don't do it that way. You're going to be crushed. The Dracos will crush you because that's what they do. They're crushers. They're ruthless. They don't have any compassion, mercy whatsoever for you. None. And they have all the power and they have the capacity to manipulate and also. You're going to be crushed. And what works is to recognize all authority in this hypothetical is imaginary authority, and that it's only a hypothetical. There is no third option. You're not, this kingdom of existence is not built upon any foundation other than a hypothetical. That is it, and that's no foundation at all, except it's our imagination. But we keep insisting that it's built on a foundation that's neither true nor hypothetical. We keep insisting on that. No, you say, there's something else, and we're just working on it. We're pouring it. We're working on the formula to pour this foundation. We're figuring out a way to to take a little of this and a little of this, little of reality, little of hypothetical, mix them together and come up with something that's entirely new. Not true. Not true. That will still be hypothetical. It's always hypothetical. And when you see it, it will either always be in a hypothetical or always be in reality. There isn't any other option for us. Then we can choose which one do we really want. And then we can exchange hypotheticals, at least being honest and, yeah, okay, I'm choosing hypothetical now. Entirely, this is what I've been choosing, so let me exchange hypotheticals for sake of continuity. It's a no-brainer. It's easy. It's not a problem. Except there are these roadblocks telling you, you can't do that. It's because the imaginary authority says, we didn't give you any authority to do that. And you say, well, no, you didn't. But I've realized that it's all imaginary authority here in the hypothetical. So it's not real authority at all. So what you're basically saying is that you don't have any real authority to tell me that I can't do this. That's true. No real authority can tell you that you can't choose reality, that you can't exchange hypotheticals, that you can't choose reality, go back to reality. There's no authority, real authority whatsoever, saying that you can't do that. None. Reality is not saying that. Reality is the only authority there is. Either we're listening to true authority or hypothetical authority. One or the other. And hypothetical authority is no authority at all. And yet don't oppose it at the level of hypothetical authority. Cannot. The Holy Spirit speaks for God. Speaks for real authority. And tells us, exchange hypotheticals first, okay? But don't oppose within a hypothetical that we're entertaining, hypothetical annihilation, don't oppose that authority at that level of hypothetical, because you're going to lose. Because there's egomaniacs running the situation, and you're not an egomaniac. And egomaniacs will take measures that you will not take, cannot even contemplate taking. They will do it, and they will do it without even a second thought, you see. And so don't do it, is what I'm saying. And of course, many will. I know that. Many will. Jesus told Barabbas, don't do it. Don't do it. And then Barabbas turned him over to the Sanhedrin saying, hey, this guy's been breaking all the laws on the Sabbath and he needs to be crucified. Why? Because Barabbas felt that Jesus was pacifying Judea and leading people to this pacifistic approach towards the Roman authority. Jesus was leading people towards salvation from the hypothetical, all imaginary authority, not just the Roman, all authority in the past of the hypothetical, all authority in the future of the hypothetical, in all imaginary authority altogether. Jesus was leading us to freedom from that. But Barabbas thought that he was pacifying the people of Judea and they wouldn't be vicious soldiers and fighters if he kept doing that. So he went to the Sanhedrin and said, hey, look what I'm trying to lower your taxes here and put the pressure on Rome. This guy is interfering with what I'm doing. And so he made a deal with the Sanhedrin and turned Jesus over to them. And then they brought formal charges and then condemned him and then insisted that a Pilate carry out their condemnation of him, which Pilate said, no, I don't see anything wrong. He hasn't done anything wrong as far as I'm concerned. Because Jesus was pacifying everybody, and Pilate said, hey, that's fine with me, being a proxy for Rome. Pilate said, hey, this is fine. This is great. There's no problem. I don't see a problem with Jesus whatsoever. This is a matter that this is your problem, not mine. And since Roman law is in effect here, I can't crucify him. And then it was such a problem for Pilate. He said, well, I'll tell you what, you can either decide to crucify Barabbas or Jesus. You choose. I'm going to wash my hands of this whole thing. And then they chose Barabbas, you see. So the world chooses the Barabbas equation of trying to fight imaginary authority with another imaginary authority, trying to fight imaginary authority with imaginary authority. That's a losing proposition. And they said, Jesus, your way isn't the way, it's not going to work. And they didn't, because they didn't understand it. But we've had 2,000 years to try to understand it. And unfortunately, there's many in the world who still don't understand it. And they still are dealing with level confusion of thinking that imaginary authority can be overcome by imaginary authority. Cannot. It's not, salvation is not a matter of overcoming, it's a matter of acceptance. Accepting there is no third option, either hypothetical or reality, and then realizing for sake of continuity we need to exchange hypotheticals so we can get back to accepting reality as it is. It's just a practical acceptance, a wisdom and clarity, that's it. We don't need to oppose imaginary authority. We're spirit. We're under the authority of reality. What are we doing trying to oppose imaginary authority and fight against it? You don't need to fight against it. Jesus said, resist not evil. Love your enemy. Agree with your adversary. In other words, don't fight against imaginary authority. That's not the way. Just recognize it is imaginary authority. So this is imaginary authority. And it's based on a hypothetical. And it's not based on some gap between reality and a hypothetical. It's not based on, so therefore, I'm perfectly capable of accepting another hypothetical and then having that translated back to reality. But if we think there's some gap between hypothetical and reality, we're working on how to bridge that gap, right? And then, so then we feel stuck within this hypothetical, the imaginary authority. We see we have to figure out a way to bridge it successfully, and then we get caught up in all these battles between humans and Dracos, which have been going on for a long time in the galaxy. It needs to stop. Both sides need to follow the way that Jesus laid out for us, which is the true way. Both sides have to do that. See, to stop this idiocy is crazy. There must be a better way. There must be a better way. And there is. There's just one way. He's realized there is no gap between hypothetical and reality. There's no gap at all. We're either choosing one or the other. And we don't need to bridge any gap. The only issue we have is one of continuity. That's the only issue we have. We don't have a bridge gapping issue. So we can simply recognize that the hypothetical authority within this hypothetical can be exchanged for the hypothetical authority in the other happy hypothetical, which is the authority of the Holy Spirit, which is a truly, totally benign and blessing and blissful, and that this hypothetical has no annihilation in it whatsoever, no death, no threat, no sickness, whatever, and that is still an imaginary hypothetical authority, okay, as far as the talking about it. And there's no bridge to gap except continuity, and that's not a gap. That's not a gap. That's not some third option. Okay, it's not a third option. It's not either true, neither true nor hypothetical, but based on something else. Therefore, we have to figure out what that something else is. It's not there. We don't have to figure out what nothing is. How can we figure out what nothing is? We're trying to do that. And the Dracos say they have a better way to do that. And the humans say, no, we have a better way. And they're at each other's throats. Why take sides at all? Why not take the side of truth? Why not take the side of the bridge being simply one of continuity? Why not take the side of honesty? Why not take the side of salvation? Why not take the side of what works? Why not take that side? That's the question. Be on fire for that. And when you're on fire for that, you go towards that. You go towards it. I feel like I've been going towards that. I'm not going to count my chickens before they're hatched. So stay on fire for it. Take, say, this whole struggle of imaginary authority is insane. Choose the hypothetical where the authority is no issue, because they realize there is no gap. There's never be any annihilation. We don't need a contingency plan for some other identity, some other reality, in case reality is destroyed, or in case our identity is destroyed. We don't need that. Therefore, what need is their authority? They're simply abiding in the bliss, the ever freshness of each moment. That's it. And then anything that is helpful, the Holy Spirit will certainly inform us of what is helpful. And we say, fine, because we realize it's not that authority is not undermining our bliss at all, our freedom, our happiness. It's not undermining it in any way. It's only helpful in sharing it. It's only to share it with others so they can showcase it and highlight it. That's it. And the Holy Spirit understands that this also authority is imaginary because it's in the hypothetical. It understands. It knows that. It knows that because it was created specifically by God as a blessing upon the hypothetical to bless our way back home, as it were. And then once we are home, once we accept reality as it is, the Holy Spirit will remain to bless reality. To bless reality. To expand the bliss of reality. It will remain there. So, be on fire for focus. Be on fire to be focused. Be on fire to hear what needs to be said from focus. Focus brings out this speech. It comes from focus. It comes from being on fire with this focus. That's where it comes from. And then when I'm not so much focused, the words aren't there. The words aren't there. It comes from focus. And so when you get that focus, you'll say, yeah. I see this. And then when you go watch television, it's like, it's not there. It's gone. It's vanished. Because you think, oh, no, I'm in the third kingdom. This neither hypothetical nor reality. I'm dwelling in this other place. You're not. It's what you're dwelling in, the hypothetical. Which is really no dwelling place at all. It's only a hypothetical dwelling place. It's saying, what if there were such a dwelling place? You're not really here at all, which is why you're not happy, which is why the flesh can't bring you happiness, because you're not even here. You're unhappy because you're imagining that you're someplace you're not. How can you be happy in an imaginary place where you're not even there? You cannot be. You really cannot be, because you're insisting that it's based on annihilation. Now, when you choose the hypothetical of non-annihilation, it's saying, what if I weren't here? What if I weren't in a hypothetical? Then you can be blissful from that. It's not the great bliss of reality, but it is very blissful and refreshing. Well, in other words, what if I weren't leaving reality? What if I never had to leave reality? See, that's still a what if. Ooh, storm is coming. Storm is coming. Yeah, just one second.
I'll get my medicine.
Okay. All right. So, a storm is coming. Oh, gosh, California is like, gosh, we're getting a full dose of winter here, which we're not very happy about that and used to it, really. I mean, so spoiled. But this is just, it's been over a month. It's like a month of just raw winter. Wow. All the more reason to stay on fire with focus, isn't it? All the more reason. You can't let anything stop your focus. Absolutely not. Now, what do you do with the rest of the day? That's a question, isn't it? That's why a society based on spiritual focus is so important, because it keeps you occupied. You go from one focus to another focus. You go from this to studying some book, to meditation, to prayer, to a satsang, to a meeting, to more prayer, maybe a lunch with other people of like mind. Then you go to a talk from a sage, and you keep your day, your weekend going that way. But who does that? Who does that in modern contemporary Western culture? Kidding. Super, super, super rare. But most we can come up with usually is like occasional retreats if you can afford it. Most of us can't afford that at all. Are you kidding? And so, focus is super difficult, which is why I make these videos long, is to give you the opportunity to spend some of your day in focus. If making it 5 minutes is not very helpful, really, because you have to keep the focus going. You got to get used to every day keeping the fire of that focus going throughout the day, not just for 5 minutes. That's kindergarten stuff, and right now we're into graduate stuff. This is graduate school we're in right now, because we have to graduate. Otherwise, we're going to end up with one or two mistakes. one, that martyrdom and death is the way, or that submission to the Dracos is the way. Neither of them is the way. That's not... No. And here come the sanitation engineers to get rid of what they don't want. Finished, see? Like that. I could have said, here come the Dracos, here come the Dracos. Picking up the trash, throwing it in the compactor, compacting it, sending it to the dump. That's it. That's it. When the Dracos come, that's it. That's it. You better not be trash at that time. You better not be trash. You better be aligned with spiritual identity. Right now, you better be aligned with it. So let's keep up our prayers that spiritual identity showcases itself here in this world for our benefit at this time. Let's keep up those prayers. Keep up those expectations. Very important. All right. Oh. And keep up that fire focus all day, right now, all day, every day. And we'll help out as much as possible here. Okay. Very great. That's it.